Amistad and Harper Audio present Make Money Move, A Guide to Financial Wellness by Lauren Simmons. This is the author. A note before we begin. Don't forget to download the accompany enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider. It contains worksheets, charts, and more, and will be referred to throughout as the enhancement. This book is written as a source of information about finances and financial well-being and to provide listeners with a general overview of financial markets and how they work. It is not designed to be a definitive investment guide, nor to take the place of advice from a qualified financial planner or other professional. Neither the publisher nor the author assume liability of any kind for any losses that may be sustained as a result of applying the methods suggested in this book, and any such liability is hereby expressly disclaimed. All efforts have been made to ensure the accuracy of the information contained in this book as of the date published. I dedicate this book to my twin brother. My brother motivates me. He's the reason why I have this fire. I look at him and I have no excuses. I have this burn. He's the reason that I'm doing this. If you don't have motivation, it is really hard to achieve and manifest any goals, whether you're working out or writing music, whether you're an actor or a dancer or an entrepreneur. If you don't have something that makes you want to get up every day and achieve, something that motivates you, then I wish for you that love, that spark, that joy. I hope that you will feel the love that I have for my twin. Introduction. On March 7, 2017, at just 22 years old, I arrived on the trading floor of the New York Stock Exchange. The day, Fearless Girl, the now iconic bronze sculpture by Christian Visible, was installed on Broad Street right across the street from the New York Stock Exchange building. Little did I know I would go on to shatter the proverbial glass ceiling by being the youngest trader ever at the New York Stock Exchange and only full-time female equity trader at the exchange. I was working for Rosenblatt Securities as the Wolfette of Wall Street, which is how Harper Bazaar warmly described me. I was also just the second African-American woman equity trader in New York Stock Exchange history to sport that prestigious badge. Nothing about my early history would have suggested this path. I grew up in Marietta, Georgia, a suburb of Atlanta. I come from a small family consisting of my twin brother Lawrence, Diesel, and my younger sister Layla. We were raised in a single-parent household. In many traditions around the world, from China to West Africa, twins are believed to be good luck and are said to bring fortune to the family. While we didn't grow up wealthy in the material sense of the word, my brother and I both brought blessings to our family in unexpected ways. My mother made sure we had the basics. She purchased our home when I wasn't even a year old. She made it a priority for her kids to be raised in a house versus an apartment. She was very disciplined with money. Watching her make her money move would serve me later in life. I learned to live beneath my means and to save a majority of my income. My mother raised us on a single salary, and while she was fortunate enough to make $60,000 a year, her salary had to feed a family of four, including one with special needs whose medical bills were continuous, and so she became great at budgeting. My mother managed to save half of what she made so that we had enough to travel and could afford the occasional splurge on extras such as Xboxes. I was the kind of kid who paid close attention to what the adults did with their money. I had some good examples in my grandparents who were entrepreneurs. My grandfather owned his own trucking company, and my grandmother is a realtor. And then there was my aunt. She lived such a fabulous life. Designer clothes, cars, handbags, and a beautiful home. Looking back, I realized that just because you appear to have things doesn't mean you aren't struggling. In suburban Georgia, where I grew up, it wasn't uncommon for athletic young men to get recruited by top colleges. They were on the path to enviable multi-million-dollar sports contracts, I used to wish that I was a boy, as ridiculous as that sounds, so that I could have the accessibility to making a lot of money. I didn't know how or when, but I never doubted that one day I would be wealthy. My brother was diagnosed early with cerebral palsy and ectodermal dysplasia. He's always been very nonchalant about his disability, very matter-of-fact. Diesel has his larger-than-life personality, and he just doesn't really let too many things bring him down. He's the most vocal person I know. His head is held high. He's optimistic. Growing up, I don't think I understood where he got his strength. But in my early 20s, I was able to surrender and to see the world through my brother's optimistic lens. Identifying with his point of view on life, I felt I could achieve everything and anything. I wanted to lean into life the way Diesel does. A light bulb went off. I want you to know that even in your darkest moments, you can find the light within. And beyond finances, you can also ask yourself, what is going to be the fire that lights me day to day? For me, it's 100% my twin brother. Because Diesel's optimism against the greatest odds touched off that light in me, I was the first member of my family to graduate from college. And the day I graduated from Kennesaw State University with a bachelor's degree in genetics and a minor in statistics in late December 2016, I hopped on a plane to New York to start anew. I was wide open to opportunities that weren't related to my genetics degree. We only have one life to live. Why not pursue something you really love? My first decision was to live with my grandparents in New Jersey. Being completely honest with you now, at the time I thought it was definitely not sexy to be an adult living with grandparents or parents. Today I say, if there's a family member you trust who you can live with, put your pride aside and use the safety net for a while to get ahead. I felt that New York, with all of its limitless possibilities and opportunities, was a great place to start. New York City people are wonderfully transparent. Personally, I like the honesty and directness. You don't have to question what people are thinking. I would tell recruiters that I wanted to make six figures, and they would say I was overly ambitious, that earning six figures was unlikely just starting out. But it wasn't unattainable. I learned later it wasn't ambitious enough. I don't believe in luck, but I do believe in being in alignment with events happening the way they should work out. After hardcore networking for 3 months in New York, I faced a ton of closed doors. It was exhausting emotionally. But just as I was about to break, a door opened, leading to Richard Rosenblatt, CEO of Rosenblatt Securities. I truly do believe that everything that happens, whether it's good or bad, happens exactly when we need it. And so, that being said, I didn't seek out the New York Stock Exchange. I didn't seek out a job in finance. I was just a recent grad who was open to anything. I landed a position with Rosenblatt as an equity trader. I loved the job, but to keep it, I had to pass the Series 19 exam, an in-house New York Stock Exchange exam that is notoriously brutal. This test was no joke. It was well known that out of 5 people taking the test, 4 would fail. I mean, all I did for a month was just study for this exam. I needed to prove to myself that I could do it. My mother had very transparent conversations with me as a kid. She wanted me to have a real understanding about the way things work. My mother never allowed us to have a victim mentality. There are always solutions to every problem, she'd say. And even now that I'm an adult, and even when I feel like there are no solutions, I'm like, okay, well then, there must be something bigger. So you learn that you have to just kind of move forward, let it go, and whatever is meant to be will be. I think my mother became that way because she had to care for a son with disabilities. She had to look at life like, okay, but you can keep moving. You can keep that drive. You can keep pushing forward. And she didn't want my brother and me to feel like there was ever a dead end. She instilled that in us more than anything. I passed the Series 19 on my first try and gained an official position as an equity trader for Rosenblatt Securities at the New York Stock Exchange. I stood on the floor of the exchange knowing that I belonged there just as much as anyone else. I never saw my being an African-American woman, the lone woofette in the room with 250 white guys. The two black guys, Aaron and Tommy, were my lifelines and still are to this day, as a disadvantage. I didn't see my race and gender as barriers or deficits. Instead, I knew these were my strengths. The New York Stock Exchange was not the first time in my life I'd been the only or the other in the room. In high school, I was the only female in my architectural engineering class for 4 years, and in college, I was either an only or one of the very few in genetics. In these moments, I learned to focus on my goals and to stand in my strength. I wasn't going to allow others to make me feel as though I wasn't supposed to be there. I believe that life gives us these moments, like pieces to a larger puzzle, to help prepare us for the next moments in our lives. The second day I was on the floor of the exchange, I was told, pretty women don't wind up staying on the floor. They end up going into, like, PR or something. I was like, okay, noted. While I didn't even see myself at the time as pretty, I still had a lot of inner work to do. I was driven to prove them wrong. Some people call it ambition, but it's really all about an abundance mindset. When you're just like, there's room for me, there's a path for me. Ultimately, the men on the floor at the New York Stock Exchange showed me that we as people are more the same than not. We may be culturally or racially or physically different. We may come from different levels of privilege and access in society. But at the end of the day, most of us want the same things. During my 2 years on the trading floor, I learned to take calculated risk and how to work in a male-dominated environment. I learned budgeting and saving and got better at managing my finances while making only $12,000 a year. I learned that it was okay that I hadn't invested one dime in the stock market. It turns out that most men on the floor don't play in the market. During my time at the New York Stock Exchange, I worked with institutional clients, meaning people with a net worth over $1 million. Eventually, I left the floor and decided to not go into another traditional finance job for two reasons. One, because of what my story represents, and two, because I was told directly that I couldn't continue growing my brand and be an employee of a firm. It wasn't until I left the floor that I found my passion. I'm called to educate and demystify personal finance, particularly for those who are being left out in the dark when it comes to mind, body, money. Millennials, Gen Zers, women, minorities, and honestly, anybody on the outside looking in. There have been so many books written by successful older men about career success, business, and investing. While many are helpful and inspiring, people who feel like the other can find them difficult to relate to. The promises of success in these books feel out of reach and unachievable for people who don't look like the authors or come from similar backgrounds. It's much easier to attempt to follow in the footsteps of someone who looks like you or comes from similar circumstances. As of 2023, there are only 53 female CEOs of Fortune 500 companies. That is only 10%. Minority women account for less than 4% of roles in finance. There needs to be more overall diversity on Wall Street, and I don't just mean through hiring practices, but in clients as well. One of the most important lessons that I learned from my experience at the exchange is that money is very practical. It relies on simple math, straightforward concepts such as addition and subtraction. Even if you're not great at math, you can attain money. You can understand it. You can do it. My family and I have come a long way. I'm on my way to achieving million-dollar dreams, and I believe that using the concepts presented in this book, you can do it too. It's all about mind, body, money. So let's go make some money move. I'll show you how. Chapter 1, Financial Wellness. Financial wellness means freedom for your body and freedom for your mind. Financial wellness can have a positive effect on your entire life, not only when it comes to money and finances, but when it comes to the quality and ease of how you live. Financial stress can also cause the breakdown of your relationships with your family, friends, or partner. All of these impacts of financial stress can absolutely lead to the deterioration of your overall quality of life. According to a 2021 Capital One CreditWise survey, 73% of Americans rank their finances as the number one cause of stress in their lives. That's most people living in this country. So ask yourself this important question: what is my relationship with money? No one else is going to answer that question for you. Bad relationships with money don't discriminate. It doesn't matter if you're rich or poor. It is well known that NBA players can get contracts worth upward of $45 million per year. By definition, it would seem like they have financial wellness. Yet, so many players go bankrupt after they retire. They literally have $0 in their account. Hard to wrap your head around, right? According to Sports Illustrated, within 5 years of leaving the NBA, 60% of former NBA players are broke. So financial wellness is more than just a matter of money. You can be given a winning lottery ticket today, but does that mean you're going to stay wealthy? Are you going to be happy? Does coming into money mean that you will have better spending, investing, and saving habits? Does being rich mean that you're growing? Does it mean that you know what to do with your money? No. And so you see, the quality of the relationships between ourselves, our money, and our minds and bodies is hugely correlated. Everything we consume, both physically and mentally, even right down to the quality of sleep that we get each day, is interconnected and directly, sometimes drastically, affects how we navigate our day-to-day lives. All of our issues are interconnected. They're all important.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.